left of me. Jokers to the right, here I am, stuck in the middle with you.
Well, hello everyone, and welcome to another episode of Millennial in the Middle. I'm Connor Dehlin. Thanks for listening. Today, I'm going to share with you an interview that I had with a gentleman named Jeff Kallay. It was a really fun conversation, and I hope you enjoy it. You know, there are a lot of different ways that we as people can find commonality one with another, ways that we identify ourselves. Maybe it's from where we're from. Oh, I'm a Californian, I'm a Utah, I'm a Northerner, I'm a Southerner, I'm from the Midwest. Maybe it's, oh, I'm a Republican, I'm a Democrat. Maybe it's your faith. I'm a Muslim, I'm a Catholic, I'm an atheist. And if we're the same, we've got something in common there. Maybe it's your race, white, black, Mexican, whatever it is. You find ways to connect with others. And what's funny is in the title of this podcast, the name of this show, I call it Millennial in the Middle. I have chosen to identify myself as a millennial. I don't say Utah in the middle. I don't say white male in the middle. It's millennial in the middle. Now, beyond just the alliteration there, I have always been fascinated with the different generations in our country's history specifically and how they interrelate one with another. A generation really is just a cohort of people, a group of people that experience the same major events in your life or throughout the course of human history at similar stages in your life. And I've always, you know, I've loved talking to my great grandparents. They're a part of the greatest generation that ever lived. I've talked about them before. My grandparents were born in 1945. They're right at the start of baby boomers and those that came right after World War II. My parents are Gen Xers. And me, I'm a millennial, born in 1992. And so I've always been fascinated with, you know, the difference of my experience between my baby boomer grandparents or my great grandparents or my parents even. And I think the generations is such a good way to describe a lot of that. Now, Jeff Kallay, I had the chance to meet in more of a professional setting. The work I do a lot with higher education and work with a lot of different schools and universities. And that's how I met Jeff at some conferences. And I've had the chance to talk with him. And I realized he uses in his language all the time when he talks about boomers and millennials and Gen Z and the differences. And I latched onto that because I loved the way he talked about it. It was so entertaining. It was so engaging. And he found these ways to tie us all together through generations. And so obviously it's someone I enjoyed talking to. I reached out to him when I started this podcast, and he's been a friend of the show since, kind of giving me feedback. He's an extremely intelligent guy that I just love talking to. And frankly, even more so after this interview, I view him as kind of a mentor now in his knowledge and his background and experience. And I'm excited that I finally got him on the show to share kind of these concepts of setting a framework and foundation to get a little deeper into the theory of generations in American history. Now, I want to give a little bit of background before I play the interview, because there are some things that this will, that I think if I lay out now will help as you listen to this conversation, especially if you aren't too familiar with this idea. He talks early on about the Strauss-Howe generational theory. They've written several books where they basically make this thesis that history repeats itself. And one of the ways it repeats itself is there's basically a cycle of four different generations that go one after the next that have this cycle. And now each generation tends to be about 20 to 25 years. And each generation, and the cycle of four generations tends to be about 80 to 85 years, which also tends to be kind of the average of a lifespan, the way you look at it. And so, you know, everyone in this cycle might experience the same things, but you experience them at different points in your life. I experienced 9/11 as a 10-year-old. My grandparents experienced 9/11 and were relating it to how they felt when they saw JFK be assassinated or when they watched the Challenger explode. I couldn't relate to that. We were very different times in our lives when those events happened and it affected us in a different way. And so what we'll talk about today and what Jeff does a very good job of explaining is how this takes part in how we all relate with each other and interact with each other, to give you just a basis for the different years that you were born that decide which generations you're in. This isn't an exact science, and there are different things that you might see elsewhere, but this is what Strauss and Howe say, that baby boomers were born from 1943 to 1961. 43 to 61. Gen Xers were born from 1961 to 1981. Millennials were born from 1982 to 2004. It's a little later than some other times I've heard described there at the end. And Gen Z was born anytime from 2005 to the present. All right. So hopefully that helps you as you now listen. This conversation will lay a foundation for a lot of other conversations we have, talking about the differences of generations and even going back past the greatest generation as we look at history and how people have been thrown in the middle of some crazy things, how they've reacted, how they've gotten through it, and how our country continues to move forward because of that. One other episode note, I actually misheard Jeff during the conversation. He was saying idealist, but I heard it as idolist. So you'll hear me kind of a couple times be off, but he talks about one of the generation just having an idealist mentality. I want to make sure that's clear just so we're on the same page there. Jeff, thanks for being on the show. I hope you enjoy this. And I think we're going to have Jeff back because he provides a knowledge background that I think we all can benefit from. Enjoy. Jeff Kallay, how are we doing, my friend?
I'm doing very well, Connor. It's an honor to be here.
Oh, well, thank you for doing it. I think you're our first Southern guest on the show. And so, you know, here we're over Zoom, but I'm going to do my best to show you a little Southern hospitality. But of course, Jeff, you one-upped me. If you're listening to the podcast right now, you can't see this. But behind Jeff's head, he's got a TV screen up that is a big ultra-sized logo of Millennial in the Middle. Man, you're the best.
Well, you know, of all the millennials, which there are many, you're one of my favorites. So as a Southerner, I guess I got to put on my Southern accent and say y'all and all y'all. Do you know the difference between those?
I don't. I mean, I'm from Utah, so we say you guys, and that's just awful. I try to say y'all, but you guys are so bad.
Y'all's the best because y'all's like one of the most inclusive words we can use. So all y'all is the plural of y'all. So some people will say if there's three or more, then you say all y'all.
I like that.
You got it?
All y'all and
all y'all.
All y'all
and y'all, right?
So today
if I walk in the room and I'm like, hey, how y'all doing? Then maybe there's three people. If I walk in the room and there's like five, then say, hey, how all y'all doing? There's
so I'm
a
just
plural
gonna
say, of y'all.
So we should say right now, I hope y'all enjoy this episode.
Hope all y'all, because you got more listeners than three.
Well, let's hope so. Okay, so for all y'all listening out there, I've given a little bit of an explanation to Jeff in the intro, but I feel like I'm excited for this conversation because of all the people I've talked to about the different generations in history, I feel like you have a unique and different perspective on this that I think those listeners here can really benefit from. And you said something that I want to start with in our call the other day prepping for this episode, where you said that you think history should be taught chapterless and backwards.
Yes.
I was like, Jeff, time out. I got to go write that down. That's so good. Explain that to me.
Well, I taught history in both my student teaching and for 1 year I worked in the missions office at a mega church's Christian prep school and taught history. And I think what happens is that everyone puts it into chapters. So what happened in chapter 20 means nothing related to chapter 19, which means nothing related to chapter 21. We just compartmentalize it. And I think one, we never get to contemporary where we're at in a syllabus usually, and a high school, if we're going to say high school history,
sure,
right? And I think then you're having listened to your America 101 and people are caught up in date. I think then what we don't get is we don't get context. We don't understand that. How did we get here? All right, well, let's go back 10 years to see where we're at and what it impacted. And so I don't think you see the evolution of history properly.
Yeah.
But that's my theory. Teach it backwards and chapterless.
Yeah. And the follow-up you said to that is that we as Americans, I think we as a people in general, lack the ability to have context. I thought that was interesting. What's the danger of us not having that context?
Wow. So the ability to process with reason and critical thinking and therefore articulate your beliefs and value system to someone who might be different than you, and to have understanding and appreciation for them and their story and their version of America. So I think right now in our age, what I'm gonna call not the communication age or the information age, but the communication rage, everyone has access to opinion that might be perceived as knowledge, but maybe not the historical context to understand what that is, right? Like the word socialist has been batted around quite a bit. I'm not sure if everyone understands the context of what socialism is, or to understand that there are a number of vibrant liberal democracies that have a socialist economy.
Yeah. Right. Man, it's so interesting to me because on the show, you know, one of the goals we've talked about is, hey, we need to listen and seek to understand those that have different perspectives than us. And like I've said, the two different perspectives we've seen on the show are people that have unique experiences, backgrounds, or maybe upbringing different than yours. And the second place that we've looked at that is, okay, how do we look at history? And by understanding history, how does that change the way we feel about a current topic? And it's really all about perspective and context, like you said. So speaking of perspective, let's give all y'all a little idea for Jeff Kallay. Like, where are you from? What's your background? Tell me a little bit more about you.
Wow, I'm 57, so that's a long path. I'm a Southerner by choice. My grandparents immigrated from Eastern Europe, from Hungary and Slovakia, ended up in Pittsburgh. All the men in my family worked in the steel industry, go Steelers, United States Steel predominantly, which at that time was the largest corporation on earth. I grew up as a Catholic kid, grew up in a lily white Protestant suburb. My family moved to Florida when I was going into sixth grade, Tampa Bay. That was great. I'm a water person. I ended up finishing 4 years of college on the five-year plan at an evangelical liberal arts college called Lee College, which is now Lee University. How a Roman Catholic kid ends up in the mountains of Cleveland, Tennessee, going to an evangelical liberal arts college is a long path. But I will say, I was just talking to one of my friends, and you had a minor required in religion. So most schools, you have 120 credit hours. We had to have 130, but I'm not bitter about that. But I would say my religion minor, particularly Christian thought and Christian ethics, are two of the things I learned the most from. And I had a great liberal arts education that taught me how to think and reason and write. I worked in admissions there. 1 year teaching down in Florida, and then moved to Atlanta during the 90s Olympic boom, was in advertising and marketing, missed higher ed, came back to it via a marketing firm, saw the need for campus visits. And for the past 16 years, I've been running a small consultancy that's now part of a big firm helping schools with their campus visits. So I tour colleges for a living.
That's awesome. That's
me.
Okay. Well, thanks for that little background.
I was also a registered Republican.
Oh yeah. Tell us about
now,
this.
I still get mail from Georgia. That was kind of fascinating. I'm like you, I'm in the middle. I don't belong to either party. So.
Okay. And what I think's interesting is when you focus on campus visits and spending a lot of time now in higher ed, you see the relationships between parents and the kids and the evolution of that over the last 25 years. And I think it's put you in a unique position to have a good understanding of the different generations in America, kind of the differences between some of those and how we all interact with each other and trying to figure it out in this crazy world. And so, you know, quickly, I love the way you kind of describe the differences of the generations. Let's maybe start with the boomers. And I just want to hear like the Jeff Kallay thoughts on the differences between boomers, Gen X, Gen Y, my whole millennial, and then everything coming afterward, those Gen Z. And we've got about an hour, so go ahead.
Oh, man, don't even get me started. I'm the bitter Gen Xer in the middle. Can I give a little historical context to make
Absolutely.
This even better? So part of my work has had to help my clients understand who their client is, who their audience is. And, you know, 15 years ago, that was predominantly baby boomer parents and millennial students. That has shifted to Gen X parents and Gen Z students now. But so in the experience economy, my work is influenced by, my work is influenced by two sets of two authors. Joe Pyne and Jim Gilmore, who wrote The Experience Economy and Authenticity, two phenomenal Harvard Business School Press books. And let me say, economically, I am a capitalist, proudly so. I think it's of all the isms or the ist, it's the one that provides the individual the greatest opportunity. So that was the blueprint for that. Howe and Strauss are these two social scientist thinkers that came up with this notion of American generational theory. And I have just been preaching them and a Howe and Strauss purist. And let me give a disclaimer, we are all on our own individual America, right? Our race, our gender, where in America we were born, when our family joined the American experiment, all those things determine that. But a generation is simply a cohort that shares a history. That's all it is. Some people don't even believe in generation. And I totally get that. In America, there's a phenomenal repetitive theme because we inevitably become our parents. And generations are put into cycles. And we have the revolutionary cycle, the Civil War cycle, the great power cycle. And now we are in the tail end of the millennial cycle. You see, all you millennials in the middle are so special that Howe and Strauss named the cycle after you. Within each cycle, Connor, there are four generations. An idealist, followed by reactive, followed by a civic, followed by an adaptive. So if we go back one, before we dive into our boomers, to answer your question, right? In the great power cycle, we had the missionary, who were the idealist. We built a lot of colleges and universities in the 1800s to educate this group to go out to be missionaries for the world, right? Then reacting to that is the lost generation, particularly the men that bummed around Europe, World War I, disenfranchised. Now that you have a love or an appreciation for World War I, as I've learned on your podcast, right? And then the GI or the greatest generation were the civic generation, the generation that came together to fight fascism. And then my parents were born into the silent generation. They were called silent because as children, they were marginalized because we had World War II and the Great Depression. And then history repeats itself when we are now in the millennial cycle. So actually, before the war was over, the baby boom started. Everyone thinks the boom started when we, after the war, but it actually started when we saw we were winning the war, 1943. Mm-hmm. Don't get caught up in dates because everyone has their variation here, but somewhere 60 to 64, people say boomers, right?
Yeah. And my grandparents were all born in 1945. Like so all four of them, right? Yeah. They're right the start of that boomer generation. Right.
Exactly. So, you know, they are the idealist generation. If you look at developmental psychology, it has followed the baby boomers, right? It was all about child psychology, then adolescent psychology, then midlife, and now we're into geriatrics because until millennials, they were the largest generation in American history, 72 million of them. They were also the generation born at the height of, I'm just going to use the term, the American empire, right? And they were the first generation to be able to have time to ponder and question their feelings. Go back one or two generations and people were just working the, you know, their garden to eat or their victory garden or sewing their suits 95 times. And boomers grew up in that economic boom too, of readily available cheap food and readily available cheap clothing, right? You didn't have to grow a garden in your backyard to get food. You just went to the suburban grocery store. Sure. So extremely idealist and challenged every notion in America, right? Then following them, the new reactive or the reactive generation is my generation, and I'm born on the cusp. And Connor, cuspy kids are a whole other world.
Cuspy kids.
Born on that 3-year cusp either way, you, and actually birth order tends to play a role on cuspy kids.
Interesting.
And I'm making stereotypes, right? And I'm making generalizations.
Yes,
about
it's generation. Okay. That's what this episode's about.
Right? There's a derivative in those words. Right. If you're an older sibling born on a cusp, you tend to take on the exiting generation. If you're a younger sibling born on a cusp, you tend to take on the behaviors of the entering generation.
Okay. I would actually think it would be the opposite.
No, because think about it. Your parents have been wanting to have a child. So their firstborn or the oldest is really going to take on that first, right? And then that kind of exiting. And then 3 years later, if you're on a cusp, you take on the entering.
Okay.
There's also a form of sibling rivalry going on in that too, right? You're rebelling against, every generation rebels against the generation before it.
Yeah. Right?
So you have 62 million Gen Xers. And if you look at this, history repeats itself, right? Because we never become our parents, which is why these generations hang around for 20 years or so, right? Average is 23.4. So if you look at the idealist predominantly birth civic, so boomers predominantly birth 76 million millennials, the largest generation in American history, the most wanted generation in American history. We made massive advances in fertility. There are a lot of twins and triplets in millennials. Parents spent a lot of money to get fertile if they weren't, right? And then boomers idealistically changed the way parenting was done. I was not best friends with my parents, but boomers questioned and changed everything and became best friends with their millennial offspring. Sandwiched in the middle is a tiny generation, the Jan Brady of generations, right? Because Marsha represents the boomers. Boomers won the birthplace lottery in America. History will reveal that, right? I mean, as much as they want to complain, they won the birthplace lottery. What a great time to be born in America. And all the wealth and all the education and everything they acquired. Then along comes 62 million Gen Xers, a tiny generation. The reactive generation, we got our anger issues. We created rap, we created hip hop, right? We're the last generation to have culture in our pop culture. And we're that lost middle child, completely overlooked, have yet to have a boomer president. I mean, Barack Obama was born on the cusp. Kamala Harris is, excuse me.
You mean a Gen Xer president.
Gen Xer president, sorry.
Yeah. Right?
Right? I think everyone just tosses Gen X into the hey boomer. But if you look at it, reactives and adaptives tend to be born into economic crisis or wars, where idealists and adaptives, the boomers and millennials, tend to be born into economic booms.
Interesting.
So we never really become our parents, right? So if you look at millennials, right? Not a bad time to be born in America. Massive economic boom, right? White millennials were born into abundance, right? Three cars.
That's me, born in 1992.
Yeah, not a bad time, right? And yeah, we just came out of a little bit of recession, but you know, average American homes increased in square footage. Average homes increased stuff in weight by 50% within one generation, right? Hmm. And so you have 76 million of this huge generation. And they came at colleges and university en masse, and colleges and universities built a lot of luxury apartments and rock climbing walls and lazy rivers. And now colleges and universities have a tiny generation, Generation Z, right? We graduated the largest high school class in American history in 2010, and the roller coaster is descending because you didn't have enough people in Gen X having babies, and we as Americans have less babies.
Yeah.
So we're about to enter into a new cycle, probably coming out of COVID, because there are spiritual awakenings and secular crisis that happen within these. And the spiritual awakening is across American history when we change our inner behavior, and a secular crisis is when we change institutions. So 9/11 was a secular crisis, right? We reordered institutions.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're due for a spiritual awakening. I would argue that spiritual awakening can't happen long enough. That's my history. I don't think I got into the tone of these generations.
Yeah. For you. Well, I think that's pretty cool because we study history. Like if we were to look at ancient Greece or ancient Rome, we would generalize. We would take, you know, periods of time and say, oh, this is what was happening here and this is what was happening here. But it's harder to have that mindset when you're looking at the present or when you're talking about yourself or your parents or your kids. And what I think is cool about what you just shared right there of, with history repeating itself, like we can see ourselves all of a sudden in history. That's a different perspective.
Absolutely. And if you go back in those cycles, you will see those personalities repeating themselves.
Yeah. Right?
The revolutionary, the Civil War is the only, the Civil War cycle is the only time we only had three generations. We did not have a civic generation because we as a people were not united, right? We were.
Sure.
So there's a chance as we're about to finish out Gen Z, the adapters, and we bring in what we call a fourth turn or new cycle. There's a chance if America keeps going the way it is, history might repeat itself like the Civil War cycle and we might not have that civic generation.
Interesting. Right?
See, you millennials are civically minded and love your teams. Do you know why that is, Connor?
Why I love my team? Mm-hmm. Because my my guess would be because my team's used to winning.
Well, that's very pro.
It's easy to be a big fan when your team's winning, but no one wants to be a winner when you're losing.
When there's 76 million of you, right? Everything went in your favor. Again, this is my better Gen Xer coming out, right? So if you look at the civic mindedness of millennials, let's all team up and do good works and service learning. Service learning. I had to work on Wendy's. I didn't have time for service learning. See, that's my better Gen Xer coming through. So here's the deal. Boomers and Xers were taught to be hardcore individualists. That was in response to the collective thought of the other empire, the Soviet Union. When the Soviet Union collapsed in Eastern Europe, all of a sudden, collective and teams were okay in America. So what did we do? We immediately started teaching millennials in teams. And look at millennial pop culture. Harry Potter. Everyone bring your strengths, team up and fight evil. The Avengers, the same thing, right? That's very counter to an Xer mentality of I got my head down, I'm getting it done because I've always done that. Now, what's interesting is Gen Z is swinging back to that individualist behavior. And ask any Gen Zer, they hate team projects in their schools. And after we have recalculated campuses to be in a team environment, and our workplace, as Gen Z is entering the workplace, they don't want to sit around in team-oriented design.
Ah, man, it's so interesting when you look at it that way because it's so true. All of a sudden, it's like you're looking at yourself in the mirror going, yeah, that's how I was taught. It was my generation that everyone got participation trophies.
Correct.
And that's what you're explaining there.
Correct.
So I want to talk economics here in a minute. I know you look at things from a unique perspective there, but before we do that, let's just talk personalities quickly. Well, let's start with the boomers. What to you?
Our idolist.
Yeah, personality of the boomer. Go.
I mean, completely idolist. I think that right now.
And just for some of our listeners, explain to me idolist.
An idolist. I mean, it's just that, right? Predominantly more positive, predominantly more we're going to change it and make it better, right? We're going to, if you go back to the missionary generation, we're going to go idealistically conquer the world for Jesus, as I say, right? This notion of, it's just, it is what it is. It's a positive idealist outlook, but with change, right? And so then the reactive is completely different than that. Some anger, some angst, mm-hmm. then the civics come together. And then the adaptives are the ones that we truly, really don't know that much about because the other three generations have kind of taken all the thunder. Mm-hmm. So boomers, completely itis. I mean, boomers challenged everything, right? They did, you know, they brought about change in America. They helped with civil rights, women's issues, gender issues, sexuality, right? If you look at boomers leading the way in the chaos and upheaval of the 60s and 70s, that's idealism, right? But then boomers went from get off my cloud to get off my lawn.
Right? Well, Clint Eastwood going on.
Held on to jobs and kept Gen X at bay and are now sitting on the largest amount of wealth ever in the United States, if not in the world. So I think that because they were so big and so powerful, and that article that I sent you from The Atlantic, which the conservative point of view that was kind of anti-boomer, is we tend to think of America through a boomer mentality. That's how much power and influence boomers have had on America. Does that define and answer
Love
your
it.
Question for you? Right, they're Marsha Brady. Right. If okay. you watch the Brady,
most of my listeners probably don't watch the Brady Bunch. So,
they're missing out on America's first blended family. Right. But, you know, Marsha was the oldest and Marsha got everything of the six Brady kids. She was the first one to get her driver's license, first one to have a private bedroom. She was head cheerleader. She was homecoming queen. She was student council president. She won the birth order. She won the birthplace. Right. Boomers won the birthplace. Right.
Okay, so let's talk about those not so lucky that you're the bitter Gen Xer in the middle. That might just be the title of this episode.
But so then if you look at Jan Brady, who used to moan Marsha on the Brady reunion, and then the millennials are cute little Cindy. She's cute. She's special. Baby on board. On the Brady reunion, Cindy was still living off her parents. Marsha was about to get a divorce and had no career. And Jan was happily married and a successful architect, not at her parents' firm. So Gen X, we built schools for boomers, and then there weren't enough Gen Xers, and we closed schools. Got it? Colleges and universities, why is there so much 70s and 60s architecture in colleges and universities? The same way, why is there a fair amount of late 90s and early aughts architecture on college campuses? Mm-hmm. Massive boomer boom, massive millennial boom. There's not a lot of 70s. There's not a lot of 80s architecture on college campuses because colleges and universities had empty beds and empty seats when there weren't enough Xers. So Xers as children were raised in complete upheaval and chaos, being born in the early 60s to 1981, right? Our president resigns. Public education comes under fire. Big mainstream religions, Catholicism and the top mainstream Protestants, have massive declines in attendance and cut programs. Gen X is the latchkey generation. Do you know what that is, Connor?
Help me.
It was quite normal to have both parents working. And I myself would come home from school at second grade and you wore a key, you unlocked the door, you called your dad, you called your mom, and you stayed at home for 2-3 hours by yourself.
Interesting.
All right. So every institution, including our parents divorcing like crazy, starting in the 70s, right? Every institution and adults that were supposed to be there for us bailed on us and failed on us and left us to our own devices to raise ourselves. So we've had our head down and we've been raising ourselves and we don't trust institutions. And we didn't trust institutions way before the rest of America didn't trust institutions.
So you did lead the way there. Yeah. You can hang your hat on that.
But we're also the generation that, and this is where, look, we went from, you love music, but you predominantly know MP3s and streaming, right? I know cassettes, 8-tracks, CDs, MP3 players, and streaming. All you millennials love your vinyl. Welcome to my childhood.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, we went from a manual typewriter, right, to cloud computing. We're the generation that created the first wave of the dot-com boom in the 90s. So we're extremely technologically savvy.
Okay. Tell me about myself. Tell us about the millennials.
You're all special. Your parents' bumper stickers told me so. You know.
I was on the honor roll. I'm the parent of a student on the honor roll.
Of course.
Yes.
Yeah. And you have a ribbon for everything.
I mean, you are at graduation. Come on, Jeff.
You are the product of what you are, right? The excessiveness of the 80s, where we outspent the Soviet Union. We defeated in the West won, which the West didn't. This is my other episode. We need to talk about how not having a Marshall Plan for Russia in the 90s is coming back to bite us. But that's a whole other issue.
Jeff, right? About 10 minutes ago, I had the thought that I may need to bring you on the show like once a month, but maybe we'll set up a retainer for you and I.
Right. So you were raised in this economic boom, right, of the 80s and 90s, except for that one recession. There were so many of you, and your boomer parents had already changed so many things and began saying, this is the key point that, to sum up millennials. Boomers were born into America where institutions had all the power, right? As goes GM, so goes America, right? The school was always right. The church was always right. Millennials were born in a time when the individual had all the power and institutions very little. And their boomer parents helped make that happen. So you as millennials were born into a time of my feelings matter, I'm empowered, there's so many of you. But we kind of forced you into a collective mindset and behavior. No offense, but your music sucks. Right.
Agreed.
Music from your youth. Like, look at boy bands, purely dress alike, look alike, march in step. Right. I mean, let's all wear school uniforms. Right. Which would never fly with boomers and Xers in our individualism. Right. So I think we as a society post Soviet Union put some collectiveness on top of you that I think is a challenge.
Interesting. How do you think, I love when you talk about how we had the chance to sit around and think about our feelings.
Yes.
And we want to make sure that we're not hurting other people's feelings.
Yes.
How do you think that ties into the political climate we're in today and how that makes conversation so difficult?
Well, all right. Here's my theory on this. So if you look at America's economy, we went from an agrarian economy, right? We all had to work the land. Our economy was based upon the land, right? Then we shifted to an industrial economy. We started taking from the land and making stuff and moving to city centers. Then that in the 60s, 70s became too expensive and was outsourced to emerging economies. And we shifted to one of service and information. Now, Pine and Gilmore say we've evolved into an experiential economy, one of experiences. I don't want stuff or things. I want memories.
Mm-hmm. That's me, 100%.
In that theory of, right, Starbucks is not selling coffee. Starbucks is selling you the experience of that coffee, right? So in that economic evolution, because things are cheap and we can have them delivered by drone, we now have time to sit and ponder our feelings. And boomers started it, and Gen Xers added on to it. We're all bitter and angry, and like, I'm still pulling out Nirvana and Hole and Run DMC, right? And then millennials had more time, and now Gen Z has had even more time, right? Because we no longer wash our cars. We no longer mend our own clothes or make our own clothes or grow our own gardens. Well, some of us do, and this COVID type of thing. But we have this enormous amount of disposable time on our hands. Simultaneously, millennials and boomers were born into a world of cable television, then the onslaught of connectivity and social media.
Sure.
And no one knows how to process it, because instead of thinking about something, we watch a cat video on YouTube instead.
Mm-hmm.
So with economic boom comes the availability to sit around and ponder how you feel. And therefore, when we ponder how we feel so much, we believe our feelings are the only right ones.
Yeah, because we've developed them. We've taken the time to really commit to them.
Correct.
So the other side of that is with all of this time, we can be a bored generation. And so we have filled our time with these little devices we hold in our hands all day long and spend hours a day on TikTok, on Instagram, on social media. Like, what effect does social media have on all this in your view?
I find it fascinating that all of these things that are supposed to connect us are disconnecting us from each other. And I think ultimately from ourselves. Mm-hmm. I think the screens are heroin. They're an addiction. They're a drug. And I think that they are creating an alternate reality. And I think it is causing... And all this connectivity, our country's on the bridge, is on the, you know, the brink of civil war. And all this connectivity, we're having a mental health crisis, Generation Z. So we live our lives out on a screen.
So, you know, with this podcast, I have a lot of people that will send me messages kind of looking for my ideas or thoughts. And a lot of times I swear people message me wanting to be comforted, right? Like I get the doomsdayers of the world is so crazy. This is so bad. We've never seen anything like this before. Like, what do you think? Is this just a sign of the times? And I really struggle with that because I'm an eternal optimist. I tend to think like, everything's gonna be all right. Like in the last episode, you haven't heard this one yet, Jeff, because it hasn't been released yet. But I talk about the Beatles Revolution song, right? And they talk about a revolution. We all want to change the world, but the hook to that song is everything's gonna be all right. Like everything's gonna be all right. I tend to think in that mindset. Are our Gen Xers, or sorry, not Gen Xers, Gen Z, are they just totally screwed?
I mean, yes.
Why?
Empires come and empires go, and you are witnessing the decline of the American empire, if I want to put it out there straight. And I hate to use that word, but America is an empire. And not in the terms of the last empire, the British Empire, that had military, economic and political dominion, right? Spin your globe behind you that the viewers can't see. At the height of the empire, sun never literally set on the British Empire. Where the American Empire does not have the boundary, we have the cultural, financial, and political influence of empire across the globe. However, I'm just going to say, in all this, we have become fat, lazy, excessive, and decadent. And we're more concerned about our feelings than we are about creating jobs. And we're more concerned about being red and blue than we are about fixing issues in America. We are more worried about what side we are on instead of embracing the diversity that is the greatness of America, right? China is 92.5% Chinese. Japan is 98% Japanese. The United Kingdom is 87.5% white. The diversity of America is what makes it great. And if we don't figure that out, then the American empire is done.
Man, I...
Come back to the theory of economic progression. Let me quiz you.
Go.
Name five...
Oh, you said me do it.
Let me quiz you.
Okay.
Global, and this to my point of why I look at everything economically, okay? And I'm going to come to a positive point of this. Right? The capital of the world 100 years ago was London. Good Lord, they couldn't even stay in the EU now. Right? There are 118 million Chinese equivalent to Gen Z.
Wow.
In the global Fortune 500, of the top 10, can you name them?
I would say
not the most valued top 10 in revenue.
I mean, I would say Amazon.
Amazon is number 9.
I would say Google.
Nope.
Google's not there.
Nope. That's such a millennial view going down technology.
Oh, crap. Well, the next thing I'm going to say is Facebook.
Nope. Nor Apple.
Man, I feel like you're setting me up for a trick question here. Global.
Global.
Are we talking oil companies like an Exxon?
Yeah. Nope. No, they fell out.
Oh, yeah. They had their issues.
Ready? Walmart number 1.
Okay. Yeah, that was a blank. How'd I miss that one?
Walmart and Amazon are the only 2 American companies in the global Fortune 500.
Interesting.
Top 10. Consumption.
And all the others we probably never heard of.
You know, OPEC Group, State Grid, and China National Petroleum are 2, 3, and 4. Royal Dutch Shell, Saudi Aramco, Volkswagen, BP, Amazon, and Toyota. So we make cars or we need oil for cars. Or we need those cars to get the things we buy.
Interesting.
So I look at things economically. America's top largest companies are about consumption. What do we do? What do we make? Every year, another Chinese company kicks an American company out of the top 10. So do I have hope? Yeah. We need to figure out what America we're going to be.
Yeah. You know, I listened to that.
Speaking of liberal democracy, right? Or are we going to figure out, like the United Kingdom is trying to figure out, like, where do they fit in? And, right, where do we fit in?
It's so funny because as you said this, my millennial mentality was triggered here for a couple different reasons.
Yes.
One, because I have my feelings, right? And my feelings are, I love my team.
Yeah,
America is my team, right? Like, it's funny. There's nothing I enjoy more than any opportunity I get to cheer for the red, white, and blue. Sure. Whether that be the Olympics, in golf, it's the Ryder Cup. Like, I just love rooting for my team of America. Sure. And to hear that, I think that, you know, one, we can take it and just be really depressed and, oh, this is going to be awful or that. Or we say, okay, what can we do to try and decide, just like you said, what America do we want to be? And I think embracing that diversity, listening to each other, opening our minds and not being such a blinder mentality of this is the only way to do things, I think is really our only way to try to make sure that course doesn't happen.
You know, ultimately, Connor, I think we all need to look in the mirror and ask ourselves, what have we done to bring about the divide in America? What can we do to fix this divide? And what can we do to keep America a beacon and champion of global liberal democracy?
Yeah. Jeff, I have not had a repeat guest on the show yet. I would like you to be my first. Can we have a follow-up conversation to this and take a couple different angles?
Sure. I don't know if your listeners want to. But...
yeah, maybe I'll rescind that invitation if no one listens to this episode.
And that's why I look at everything economically, right? I mean, you'd ask me about that, and what is the buying power of millennials in those numbers? Where are we as an economy?
Yeah. Hey, actually, I got to ask one question while I have you on here. You're in higher ed. You do
a lot
with colleges, education.
I do.
What do you, like, with this whole generation feel, are you worried about the fact that people are placing less emphasis on, like, a college education and more this non-traditional? Real quick, just what are your thoughts on that?
I don't think place-based education is for everyone. I don't think a college degree is for everyone. But I think that COVID has shown our cracks in our society, and higher ed is filled with many of them. And I think that what has happened is we've looked at a degree as a means to make money instead of as a means to create, maybe. I think I can answer that question better when our new normal becomes less new normal and more normal Here's my concern with higher ed. And if you look at applications being down, except at hyper elites, I think that higher place-based education is going to be available to the wealthy. Right. FAFSA, the financial aid document, that those filings are down. We have less applications from first-generation students. And as a first-generation college graduate whose grandparents were immigrants, I have a heart to that. I don't think everyone needs a college degree, but I think to advance our economy, we need an educated people.
Interesting.
We need people that don't just take jobs. We need people that create jobs.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at my American Fortune 500, 75% of those CEO have liberal arts degrees, and that's my plug for liberal arts. But most people don't even know what liberal arts is, so that's a whole other discussion.
No, I think that's great. I mean, I know in my personal experience as a millennial, like I viewed going to college as the means to get a job. And all of a sudden when I had a good job and was in the career I wanted, it was like, oh, well, what's the purpose of that? Right. And I think remembering that, hey, we want to go to better ourselves, to learn, to be able to provide more value to society. I hope that trend stays in place, but we may change the way we do it. And that's okay.
Right. I think the problem is college, like America, thank you boomers who wanted it for their millennial kids. We took college from a Spartan lifestyle that it was and made it a luxury.
Yeah.
Right? To recruit millennials, of which there are more than the other, colleges built luxury housing, right? Put in dining halls that rival five-star restaurants. Built fitness centers with, you know, rock climbing walls and lazy rivers, things that in the NFL rivals a professional sports team. That and so
it's the experience.
But what expectation does that set?
Yeah, and why are you really there?
How hungry is America, Connor?
I'm fed just fine. We go on diets. Oh, man. All right. I love this conversation. Jeff, I'm going to end it here. I think it's a good conversation to be able to set the framework for a lot of cool episodes. I plan on further of diving into some of those generations and bringing on representatives of those generations. So thank you for helping me kind of paint the picture and lay the foundations for that. And I am going to have you back at some point. We'll figure that out.
My pleasure. My honor. I hope I provided some context for you and your listeners.
Oh yeah. And I'm going to say this. I hope all y'all enjoyed it. And I'll end it this way for all y'all. Clowns to left me, jokers to the right. Here I am, stuck in the middle with you. Hey, you weren't going to sing, but you did it. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you next time. Clowns to the left of me.